The Arctic. At the other end of the world, things are very different. The Antarctic continent is surrounded by the Southern Ocean, the world's widest ocean, which roars around the earth, untrammeled by land. And while the Antarctic is land surrounded by water, the Arctic water is surrounded by land. The pole itself is merely a spot in the ocean, usually icy, but sometimes watery. As we saw in chapter 6, you remember, the Arctic Ocean is probably the most sluggish in the world. It receives the least solar energy to get things going, and it is connected only tenuously to the rest of the world ocean via the Bering Straits between Alaska and Siberia, two bigger seaways to either side of Greenland. So it takes in only limited amounts of warmer water from further south.
The hydrological cycle, the big message of this book is that the Earth is a single, understandable term in which everything joins together. Now we are more important than when we consider the hydrological cycle. This is the machine that connects the Earth's airy, watery, and icy zones. In these patches, these parts would have led to a muddle. But a water molecule that is in the Atlantic today could tomorrow form part of a snow drift in Greenland, or be carried along in a steam in France. The least familiar volcanoes are those that appear under the sea, typically at centers of ocean floor spreading. As well as fresh lava, these volcanoes, known as hydrothermal vents, produce a huge amount of hot or even boiling water, depending on their depth below the surface, and some are called black smokers. In honor of their carbon-rich dark emissions, see color section P5, the energy released by these vents doesn't go to waste, as they are home to a lively ecology of fish, shellfish, and other animals. Stand clear, volcanoes are beautiful, but they are also hazardous. When Mount St. Helens erupted in 1980, the wave of debris, steam, and gas that surged out moved it up to 110 kilometers per hour, and 540 million tons of ash were emitted.
Extinction is forever, used to be a green movement slogan. It's really true, thanks to the wonders of genetic engineering. It's becoming possible to recreate lost creatures prepared to get into the air. The quagga, a species of turtle, whose last member died in Amsterdam Zoo in 1883, is one animal that might get a recreation. In case you are wondering, it's far trickier to do this with long-extinct animals. For example, dinosaurs. One reason is that the plants they used to eat have also gone extinct, and those that exist today might be toxic to them. More importantly, you need a near relative to give birth to the revived species. Although some creatures can be driven to extinction by humans killing them off, far more are put in danger by having their habitat removed around them. So like climate change, extinction is important in its own right, but also for what it tells us about how we are changing the Earth.
Come to me.